Hello, I'm Tony Guida. This is my New York. If you like to eat well, if you favor fresh food from the farmer's market or the local butcher and baker, you're a disciple of James Beard. Beard preached farm-to-table cooking long before anyone called it that. He became one of the most famous people in America, a celebrated chef, but a man unknown. Now we get the man in full, the man who ate too much. A new biography presents Beard as a gay man living closeted and afraid, even as his fame flourished. Author John Birdsall cooked in professional kitchens for 17 years. He is a food writer with two James Beard Awards. Birdsall on Beard, next. John Birdsall, welcome to the program. This is a riveting interpretation of a life, and I'm just stunned by the evocative writing, the beautiful writing that about food that, you know, I could smell and taste it, or at least I felt I could. And thank you for that.
Well, thank you.
I want to start with a quote that really struck me. John Farone, who was a friend of Beard's, you quote him as saying, for Beard, food was autobiography. What did he mean?
Well, James had such a long and sort of colorful life in food. I mean, he was born in 1903 in Portland, Oregon, but became really closely associated with New York City starting in the 1940s when he started writing cookbooks. And he really used his past and his knowledge and experience of food as a way of, nowadays we'd say branding himself as the foremost expert on food and drink in America, but also kind of embodying this new post-war kind of gourmet lifestyle, even though he hated the word gourmet. And so he could kind of use, refashion, kind of mythologize parts of his own life around food as a way of really kind of bolstering this idea of himself as the dean of American cookery.
Some of his earliest memories that you write about are the foods that his mother prepared, he would sample at the seashore in Oregon. And she ran a boarding house there for a time. And he has a sense memory or taste memory of those foods from when he was, 6 and 7 and 8 years old.
Yeah, people who knew James would always comment on his amazing memory for what he had eaten and tasted in his life. I think he probably did have a really great memory, but I think he was also really talented at kind of convincing people about sort of stories that he told. They seem completely authentic, and I think he did learn from his mother. She had a very difficult marriage to James's father. He was an only child. Their marriage was really for kind of social convenience rather than, any affection. And through his mother, he really learned to use food as a way of kind of emotional expression, as a way of, expressing joy and pleasure, despite having a life that didn't really allow those things. So food was this tremendous carrier of kind of emotion, of memory, of identity for James.
You talk about food for him being rapture. And of course, when he became famous with the television show in 1946, first celebrity television chef,
right.
The show is called I Love to Eat with an exclamation point. Let's talk about that rapture, because it seems what you're suggesting or you're beginning to talk about is food being a rapture for him that he could publicly indulge and a sort of a symbol for raptures that he couldn't reveal publicly.
Yeah, there were so many things that he couldn't express publicly. Being gay, being in the closet, And so, yes, you're absolutely right. Food kind of carried this message of pleasure, of enjoyment, of reorienting life around food in a way that was really foreign to Americans in the 1940s and 1950s. James was able to really kind of popularize this message, you know, democratize it. And, you know, it was something that he and others of his generation learned outside of the United States, you know, traveling and eating in France, Italy, Spain, places where food was a focus of life in many ways.
Yes.
And so kind of introducing that, you know, James was really talented. He was really skilled at being able to bring that message, not as a foreign one, not as, you know, cook French food like the French, but to really take those principles and apply them to this really kind of native American style of cooking with American ingredients.
Yeah, I think you refer to it as what you call James's genius, that he, I'll use the phrase, Americanized French food for people who were, for a culture that was and adored the haute cuisine of French food, but he brought it to them in kind of an American way. Am I saying that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, not only sort of taking recognizable, you know, very kind of simple rustic French recipes, you know, things like cassoulet, you know, things like, you know, braised beef stews, and using American terminology for them, you know, not calling it bœuf bourguignon, but calling it, you know, beef stew. And so James really was skilled at, you know, taking all of those ideas, impulses from French food, this whole sort of style of, you know, shopping and cooking with a great deal of care, but really infusing that in American home cooking.
He was teaching Americans to cook.
Right.
With this food that he adored in France and Spain and other places. But at the same time, I think demystifying it for them and saying, yeah, hey, you can find ingredients in your, you know, local shops, your markets, as good as, you know, something from France, and you can make this.
Yeah, and even just the food itself, like, you know, getting Americans to look at things that they ate every day with new eyes and to commit to maybe cooking those things in a more careful manner. So, you know, James was a great champion for, you know, something as simple as ham and eggs. Right. And, you know, tried to tell Americans that a dish of ham and eggs, if cooked properly, could be as great as something as, you know, that you might eat in France.
I think you write in the book somewhere that he could be as much in love with a good club sandwich as he was with veal Oscar.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, part of that, or what was essential to that, was how you shopped and how you cooked. You know, you could assemble all the ingredients of a great club sandwich. You know, you would buy your chicken with care. You would, you know, maybe forego the big gleaming supermarket in the 1950s and get to know your local butcher in your neighborhood. And you would seek out better bread, or maybe even bake bread yourself, because, you know, American sliced white bread, which was kind of the great marvel of the post-war world, was just horrible, of course.
Yeah.
So it was a message of simplicity, but within that, it was to really respect ingredients.
I want to get back to this food is rapture just for a minute, and I mean that's what we're talking about. Not get back to food as rapture. It becomes embodied or pictured, illustrated on the cover of the James Beard cookbook, which is what the book he became famous for. It sold gazillion copies.
Yeah, in 1959.
The cover, describe the cover and how it indicates his love for food.
First of all, it was the first book that showed the cookbook author on the cover, or an actual photograph of the cookbook author, rather than like a stylized illustration, something like that. Dell wanted to publish the James Beard cookbook as an inexpensive paperback. It costs 75 cents, and it's a thick, sort of comprehensive book. And so, you know, it would be sold in drugstores and at newsstands. It would be accessible to almost every American. And so using James's photograph on the cover, you know, his physical size, he was 6'3", he weighed, you know, 300 pounds and more during the 1950s. It was really this physical embodiment of this message of eating for pleasure, of eating and drinking well. You know, at the same time, the 1950s were a time of almost obsessive dieting for Americans. You know, diet books were among the best-selling books of the time. And so James has himself photographed with this platter of choucroute garni, which is this very rich, fatty pork dish, French Alsatian dish of sauerkraut baked with sausages and pork shoulder and ham. And some of the editors were really worried that it looked a little gross, that it wasn't, you know, a very sexy or marketable message for Americans. But it worked. You know, the cookbook was one of his best-selling books, and it really went even further than kind of than his previous books at really establishing his public persona as this person just in love, so in love with food that his physical size was really not an issue. You know, Americans should just relax and enjoy what they ate.
Yeah. And interesting, you say that it was his most successful book. It sold, you know, gazillions, and it made him more famous than he already was, and yet he hated it.
James wanted to always yearn to sort of write a very personal book, a narrative cookbook full of voice and personality. You know, several of those books were published in America, but they were cookbooks that didn't sell very well overall. You know, the huge selling cookbooks were The Joy of Cooking, you know, House and Garden Picture Cookbook, the Betty Crocker cookbooks, which sold tremendously well. These were like cooking Bibles or comprehensive. They might have, you know,
he didn't want to write a kitchen Bible.
Right, exactly. So it was really the sort of pressure of publishing at the time that he write a really comprehensive book. You know, it even includes a sort of arch recipe for how to boil water, like how to bring a pan of water to the boil. But yeah, I mean, you know, Americans didn't buy a lot of cookbooks, even in the 1950s. They wanted just a few practical books that could tell them how to cook everything that they might want to cook. And so, you know, James's sort of Faustian bargain was with this book was, it made him famous, but at the same time, it was, you know, the least, his least favorite book in many ways.
I think you say a couple of times during in the book that, you know, what he wanted to write was about food as a narrative, as a story with his voice. And I wonder, do you think he came closest to that in a book he put out in, 1964? The book was called Delights and Prejudices. Do you think he came close to it in that?
Yeah, he did. You know, he had wanted to write something that was broadly autobiographical, but that didn't, you know, but obviously there were a lot of details about his life that he couldn't tell, things that he had to keep secret. And so it was a book, he was going to tell the story of his life in food, in meals. So in a way it was an autobiographical book that didn't look too closely at his own actual life. But he does, the best part of the book is James's, he talks about his childhood growing up in Portland, Oregon, and along the Oregon coast, his relationship with his mother and her food. And he sort of, you know, bends the facts and mythologizes a bit, but it is an attempt to not only talk about a life as a series of meals, as a series of impressions about food, but it's also very localized within that sort of part of Oregon. And really for 1964, I mean, when I spoke with Alice Waters of Shape and Nice in Berkeley about knowing James Beard, she said that, you know, from really pretty early in her career, she was really inspired by this book, Delights and Prejudices, for the way that it, you know, essentially contains in many ways the roots of the farm to table concept, that what you ate in a particular corner of where you grew up was essential. And it was a new model for this kind of emerging type of American cooking.
Yeah, you talk about the dust cover as being an indelible rendering of James, and it's okay. And I think we're going to show it. Is that a signed copy, by the way? That's
no, it's not actually.
I see some are for sale on the internet. You seem to make the point that you know, he, I mean, James Beard is a dichotomy, this public, you know, man, this large, joyous looking man in love with food for the public, and a whole private life that he can't reveal at all. And is that, talk about what you see in that rendering on the cover of the book.
Yeah, so it's a great sort of drawing by Earl Follander, great San Francisco illustrator. And it's a picture of James as he was in 1964. And he's eating alone on the beach at Oregon where he grew up. So he's sort of looking out at the cliffs and the water. He's being served by a waiter in a white coat. And it's this kind of wonderful illustration because it places James in the landscape, which is what the book does. But it's also sad in many ways because James is absolutely alone. And he's, you know, having a solitary meal facing the ocean. In many ways, that was the way James's life was. I mean, as a boy growing up in this magnificent landscape with all of the food, the wild berries, the wild salmon that it offered, his family life, his life with his parents was very emotionally sort of barren. He was a very kind of lonely boy. He and his mother and father tended to eat their meals by themselves. They kind of rarely came together as a family. And then sort of James, as an adult, he had very close friends who were also either gay or lesbian that he couldn't talk about. And so in many ways, he ate alone. He always called himself, you know, an inveterate bachelor. And so he had this persona of someone who's kind of absolutely kind of emotionally cut off.
Another of your quotes from the book is struck me, where you say queerness was not just an interesting footnote to Beard's life, queerness was its central principle. And I think you've been talking about that.
Yeah, it was, you know, he had very deep relationships with queer friends that he, again, that he couldn't really talk about. So the most meaningful parts of his life had to happen off screen, off the pages of his books, which, you know, certainly was not uncommon for LGBT Americans of his time. If they were able to sort of express their sexuality in any way, it really had to be in these very private enclaves, and their professional lives, their public lives, had to be walled off quite strictly from that private life. And it was, you know, he could experience great sort of joy with his friends, but ultimately it was a life about denial, you know, about destroying letters that might be quote unquote incriminating.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Sort of, you know, denying the deepest part of himself to the public.
Let's talk briefly about unpleasant side of James, his, I think you call it ugly ambition. Yes. He stole a lot of his, plagiarized and stole a lot of the material that he published.
Things that would be considered unethical now were kind of allowed in the cookbook field, certainly. But James was especially egregious. He had to produce a tremendous amount of content every year. I mean, it's hard now in 2020 to make a living as a cookbook author, and it was just as hard in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s. And so he had to churn out just a tremendous number of recipes every year for his books, his syndicated newspaper column, magazine articles. And part of the way that he did this was by plagiarizing himself, his earlier works, but also sort of plagiarizing his friends and colleagues, using recipes from friends without always, usually not identifying where they were from. Even, quite a close friend, Helen Evans Brown, great cookbook writer from Pasadena. They collaborated on a book. And while they were doing that, James was, writing his own books, his own solo book on the side, and kind of took some of Helen's recipes, took some of the recipes he created with Helen, and sort of published them, not even mentioning Helen. And he did this really all throughout his career. He kind of used his friends, used his colleagues in ways, and took credit for it. And of course, he had such great charm and charisma. And also, usually he was stealing from his colleagues in the field who were women. Most people who wrote cookbooks or were food editors were women. And he had advantages as a man. To say, but people wouldn't. They wanted to believe that James was this great author.
He's known especially today, and I hope he gets a lot better known from your book. But we all know about the James Beard Awards and the James Beard Foundation, and it's something he never wanted and didn't authorize. And I think he wrote in a newspaper piece that he would hate the awards that bear his name.
Yeah, I wrote a piece for the Washington Post about that. The James Beard Foundation was created after James died. So he died in 1985. The foundation really launched in 1986. James suffered from depression all his life. And as he got older, I think it became harder for him to sort of push it away. In his final years, he really didn't want to be remembered. In his will, he specified that all of his possessions, he spent a life collecting antique kitchen equipment and majolica dishes. He had this enormous collection of kind of kitchen and food artifacts, and he wanted it to all be auctioned off. He didn't want any of it to survive. And his townhouse on West 12th Street in Greenwich Village, which is now called Beard House, he specified that be sold off. He really didn't want to leave any traces of himself. And of course, the foundation came along largely with the support of James's great friend, Julia Child, who thought, no, this can't be. We have to memorialize this sort of great figure. And so she was successful at helping to raise money to buy the townhouse, turn it into this foundation, this center of American culinary activity. The awards, which have probably kept James Beard's name alive, they started in 1990. And it's kind of ironic because, James was this great champion of home cooking at a time when restaurant chefs were not celebrities at all. And, that started happening in the late 1970s. And so right at the end of James's life, he really became eclipsed by this new generation of chefs. American food magazines were in love with these very dynamic, young chefs. And so food coverage in America in the 1970s and 80s was not really about home cooking in the way that James Beard and Julia Child practiced it, but it was teaching Americans how to cook food that they might get at a restaurant, you know, Wolfgang Puck or Larry Forgione or Alice Waters.
Well, it points to just how extraordinary and meticulous your excavation of his life is when he wanted to keep it so out of the public eye. You've done a marvelous work in this book. And I started this program talking about your evocative writing, and I must quote at least one that just... I want to go out and have oysters right now, but which is hard to do in these. But this is John Birdsall talking about some of the food that was of such rapture to James Beard and the man who came from the West Coast, Oregon. And he talks about oysters. Oysters hauled down from shoals above the terrifyingly wide mouth of the Columbia and fried in an abundance of butter. Doesn't get any better than that, John.
Well, thank you very much.
I really appreciate it. The man who ate too much, John Birdsall, it's been a delight. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a pleasure.
Okay.